What's up, you guys? Welcome back to my channel. My name is Danelle Hallan, and I am back with another true crime video. And in case you missed it, in my last video, all of my content is now being offered in podcast form, something that you guys have been waiting for such a long time. Go ahead and check out Crime Bit with Danelle Hallan wherever you consume your podcast, and it should be there. I also have it linked down below for you guys. And on top of that, I also made a website, finally. So that's kind of just like one place where you can see my YouTube links, all of my social media, where you can go ahead and submit a case suggestion. So I'm trying to organize everything, get it in one location since I am spreading out all over the place now. And also don't forget that you can watch all of my content, not just here and on my podcast, but also on Roku. So now on to today's case. Today, we are speaking about the horrific death of 5-year-old Nevaeh Buchanan, a little girl that went missing while playing during Memorial Day weekend in 2009, only to be found 11 days later encased in cement along the River Raisin. Her death deeply impacted the community, and unlike many of the cases that we look into where there's seemingly no potential leads or perpetrators, the list of possible perpetrators in this case, which mainly were sex offenders, was lengthy. So many people had access to Nevaeh that never should have. And with so many that could have harmed her, finding out who really did was, and to this day still is, a challenge. So let's get into the details and try to bring Nevaeh justice. Nevaeh was born on February 3rd, 2004, to 20-year-old Jennifer Buchanan and 17-year-old Shane Hinojosa. And I hope I pronounced that right. But she was born in Michigan. And from the get-go, her life was difficult. She lacked a lot of stability. Her father was not a very active part in her life at all due to, by his own accounts, tension between the families. And in 2006, her mother, Jennifer, was put in jail for breaking and entering in order to feed her drug habits. So this left Nevaeh in the hands of her grandmother, Sherry Buchanan. And she was only 2 years old at the time. Now, Sherry was given full custody of Nevaeh and was doing all that she could to raise her in a loving and caring environment. And at this point, Nevaeh was in fact thriving. They moved into the Charlotte Arms apartment complex on North Macomb Street in Monroe, Michigan. And this apartment was filled with kids Nevaeh could play with. It was really close to schools. So Nevaeh began attending Discovery Preschool, where she had such an amazing time. She loved to play on the playground. She loved all of her teachers. She loved to make new friends. Now, she was definitely more of a shy kid, but once you befriended her, she clung to you. Now, according to those that knew and loved her most, Nevaeh's true love, first and foremost, before all other things, was motorcycles. So much so that her favorite stuffed animal beagle was named Harley after the motorcycle. And he wasn't the only named stuffed animal of Nevaeh's. That was her second love, stuffed animals, and she had a ton of them, and every single one of them was named, and they were all well cared for by her. Nevaeh also loved her Power Wheels Escalade that she would scoot around in. And when she was outside, if she wasn't in her Power Wheels, you were likely to see her fly by on her favorite scooter. She probably was on her scooter more than she was walking. But when you could finally wrangle Nevaeh and get her to go inside, she was usually watching SpongeBob or The Jungle Book on TV. So by all accounts, she was a happy and thriving little girl. Now, after her mom was released, which from my understanding, she only served 11 months. So about the time Nevaeh was 3 was when they kind of were reunited to an extent. For a while, her mom still wasn't living with her. I believe she was still struggling with certain things in her life. So they occasionally would see each other, but Nevaeh remained in the custody of Sherry until just prior to Nevaeh's disappearance. Jennifer, at this point, wanted to get her life back on track. She wanted to be more active in Nevaeh's life. And so she decided to move into the Charlotte Arms apartment with Sherry and Nevaeh. And this seemed to work out pretty well because Nevaeh had been going to preschool, but she was about to graduate from preschool. Jennifer didn't have a job at the time, and Sherry worked all of the time. So she was able to stay home with Nevaeh while Sherry went to work. And summer was coming. It was just kind of perfect timing. And then came Memorial Day weekend, literally the start of summer. Nevaeh had just graduated from preschool days earlier, and her grandmother said that she was so excited and proud of herself. She didn't just walk across the stage for her preschool diploma, she sprinted across the stage for it. That just kind of shows the energy that she had as a kid. And she was so excited about not just graduating, but the fact that summer was about to begin. She had recently befriended an 8-year-old boy named Austin that lived in the same apartment complex. He was just a floor above her. And like I said, when she had a friend, she usually clung to them. And so she was so excited to spend the summer playing with him and play with all of the other kids around the neighborhood. And the way that the complex is set up, it is a horseshoe shape with one parking lot that goes around the complex. There's a pool situated in the middle, and it's not even necessarily directly off a main road. You have to kind of turn off of a main road and then go down the side street, and that's where you can enter the neighborhood. So it was a perfect setup living with kids. It was a very easy, safe place for her to kind of ride her scooter around in circles. Obviously, the pool is fun, and there was also a school nearby where there was a playground. So as a parent, like, that sounds like the ideal setup. Now, Sunday, May 24th, the day before Memorial Day, Sherry was working, so Nevaeh was in the care of her mother. And it was a beautiful day, so Nevaeh spent most of the time outside as expected. And Jennifer had invited over a friend of hers for the holiday, and that friend was bringing a little girl. And I think they were staying the night that night. And so Nevaeh and the little girl played outside pretty much all day. She spent some time with Austin. I believe Austin's family fed her a late lunch at like 3 or 3:30. And at around 6 or 6:30, Nevaeh popped back into her apartment for a little bit. Now, from what I've seen, she had struggles with kind of stopping the fun and going to use the restroom. So she had a bit of an accident. So she ran inside, she changed her clothes really quickly, grabbed a popsicle, and then ran out of the house barefoot. But she yelled out to her mom that she was heading upstairs to play with Austin. Jennifer at the time was watching TV in their apartment, and she had no doubt that Nevaeh would make it up the stairs to Austin's like she had done several times before. But around 30 minutes later, something was off. The little girl that had been staying at Nevaeh's that day came back to the apartment and told Jennifer that Nevaeh was playing where she shouldn't be. Despite telling her mom that she was heading to Austin's, this little girl said that Nevaeh was actually riding her scooter in the road. And by the road, I think what was meant was actually just like the parking lot area. Like, she had gone off the sidewalk and was just willy-nilly out where cars could accidentally bump into her. So Jennifer got up, she searched for her shoes for a few minutes, prepared to go outside and scold Nevaeh for breaking the rules. But when she finally got out there, Nevaeh was nowhere to be found. She began to walk around the complex and eventually located something that made her stomach drop. Nevaeh's scooter was there, abandoned, leaned up against the side of one of the apartment buildings. But there was still no sign of Nevaeh. And that was her favorite scooter. That was one of her favorite things in the world, aside from all of her motorcycle toys and Harley the Beagle. And so the idea that she just set it to the side and walked away from it was a little unsettling. She'd either gone into someone's apartment or something serious happened to her. So Nevaeh's mom, Jennifer, started to go around to different apartments that Nevaeh spent time at, asking all of her little friends if they saw her walk off, if she was inside playing somewhere, but nobody had any idea where Nevaeh had gone. So eventually, Jennifer called the apartment manager to help in the search. But by 8 p.m., they still hadn't found Nevaeh. So someone, and we don't know who, called into 911 to report her as missing. Jennifer immediately reached out to Sherry, the grandmother, who could not believe what she was hearing and rushed home from work to help look for Nevaeh. Jennifer also called her friend and ex-boyfriend George Kennedy, because this was someone that Nevaeh was apparently very close with, and she even referred to him as Daddy George. Nevaeh's father was also called, and everyone hit the ground running to try and locate her. Police arrived, and right away they began speaking to Jennifer and anyone who had been outside in the apartment complex, and it took no time at all for authorities to find a very unsettling bit of information. George Kennedy, Jennifer's friend and ex, Daddy George, was also a registered sex offender. Jennifer had met him while going to see her parole officer 2 years prior, and she claimed to police that she didn't initially know that he was a sex offender, but I guess when she did find out, she said she decided that everyone deserves a second chance. So she continued to allow this man around her young daughter. She told police that she never left her alone with George and that she didn't believe that George would ever hurt Nevaeh anyways. Nevaeh and George apparently had this very close relationship where he would bring her toys and gifts, and she was always excited to see him. But despite Jennifer's attempts at making this seem like something innocent and beautiful for Nevaeh, his history was terrifying. George had been charged in 1998 with having sex with an underage girl, a 16-year-old. Now, this charge did end up later being dismissed, but he just ended up with more. In 2001, he was charged with a home invasion where he accosted a 13-year-old girl. And for that, he was in fact convicted and thrown in prison. George had been released in 2007, and that's when he met Jennifer. And despite the terms of his parole agreements, he met Nevaeh. So we've just got bad decisions across the board. George has claimed that he and his girlfriend were out fishing when he got this frantic call from Jennifer. And so he packed up and went straight to Nevaeh's preschool to see if maybe she had wandered there to play on the playground. Now, after they searched there for a little bit to no avail, he headed to the apartment to help search there. And it was around the time that he arrived or was about to arrive that Jennifer called him again. She had told police at this point that her good friend and someone that spent a lot of time with now missing Nevaeh was on the sex offender registry. So understandably, they wanted to speak to him right away. Now, George ended up leaving the Charlotte Arms complex before speaking to anyone. And instead, he went to his home, or where he was living at the time, which was a motel located just under 3 miles from Nevaeh's apartment. Now, a lot of people have claimed that he was trying to run, that he wasn't going to turn himself in, that he had reasons for not wanting to. But George claimed that he was simply trying to do the right thing. He apparently went there to meet his parole officer and a sheriff's deputy that were waiting for him, and ultimately he was taken into custody. Now, authorities were saying at this point that he wasn't a suspect, he was just a person of interest, and instead he had actually been arrested for parole violations because he had this relationship with Nevaeh, and that didn't automatically mean that he had any involvement in her disappearance. But authorities wanted to look into the possibility that there was involvement there, so they obtained a warrant for his motel room and planned to question him. And when they went into his motel room, they found quite a few questionable pieces of evidence. There was a pair of shorts and a towel in the room that were covered in blood. Blood was also found on the wall above the bathroom sink. They also stumbled across photos of little girls. And one of the little girls that was in the photos looked a lot like Nevaeh. There were also small motorcycle toys in the room as well. And no one really knew if those were just toys he planned to give her since he did gift her a lot of things, or if they're toys that she left while visiting with her mom, or were these toys used to lure her in? They had to figure all of this out. And George seemed to have an explanation for at least the blood. He claimed that he cut himself shaving, and then he claimed that his girlfriend had gotten a tattoo. And so all of that, I guess, got the sink bloody and the shorts and the towel, and there was nothing weird going on at all. But even more alarming, when they went to go and search a van that he had been driving, in the very middle console, they found a small multi-tool, and on the outer portion of it, there was blood. And so, I mean, when you're looking at this from the outside, looking in, having bare minimum information, you've got bloody clothing, towels, little kids' toys, pictures of little girls, and a bloody knife. Like, obviously, that's going to be suspicious. So all the evidence was sent off for forensic testing while searches continued at the apartment. Authorities went to every single unit, all 180 of them, to make sure that Nevaeh wasn't hiding somewhere. I mean, she was a little girl, and sometimes little kids like to hide, play hide and seek, or maybe she didn't want to have to go home that night. There's no telling. Or maybe it could be more nefarious and someone was holding her in their apartment. But when they checked all all of these units, there was no sign of Nevaeh. And they took this opportunity to also speak to everyone that was at the apartment complex at the time to see if anyone saw or heard anything. And they did get a few tidbits of information that could possibly be helpful. Someone reported seeing a, quote, little red car speed out of the parking lot that night. And another person mentioned seeing a green van. And at this point, theories and rumors were spreading like wildfire. The kids at the complex ended up telling investigators that there was a hole in the fence beside the complex that led to that neighboring school's playground that I mentioned way earlier in the video. Maybe Nevaeh had gone through there to play and someone was lurking over there with bad intentions. More witnesses continued to come forward claiming to see a few cars in that playground parking lot around the time that Nevaeh was thought to have gone missing, along with two younger boys that were around, I think, like 7, 8, 9 years old. And so police were reaching out to the public, hoping to be able to speak to those children, figure out whose cars were in the parking lot, hoping that maybe it would lead to answers. But what was the most baffling after speaking to everyone in the apartment complex was the fact that no one heard or saw anything strange. The apartment, for the most part, was bustling. It was Memorial Day weekend. I'm sure people were at the pool. I'm sure people were out with their grills. I'm sure people were out at that playground. People were out on their balconies. Other kids were playing. But no one saw or heard anything happen to Nevaeh. They didn't hear anyone screaming or crying as if they were being abducted. So at this point, authorities couldn't really narrow down if she had maybe been taken by someone or if she had just wandered off on her own and ended up lost. So they started to really expand the searches to the nearby areas in case it was the latter. They checked the nearby woods and the fields, playgrounds, business parking lots. Hundreds of volunteers were out all night long alongside authorities to try and find little Nevaeh. And by 12:30 a.m., when they hadn't found any sign of her, an Amber Alert was sent out. They had sent out drones with infrared and helicopters, and a five-year-old girl can only get so far on her own. So at this point, because they had found no sign of her, it seemed more likely that someone took her. But this just confused her family and worried authorities even more, because according to those that knew Nevaeh best, she was so shy. She never would go off with someone that she didn't know, at least not without absolutely losing her marbles in the process. So since no one heard anything, it seemed like maybe she went off with someone that she thought that she could trust and that she personally knew. And statistically, that is the most likely scenario. When a child goes missing, way more often than not, it is usually a family member or someone that they personally know. It is not likely at all to be a stranger abduction. So obviously, that starts to narrow down the search pretty tightly. And it was around this time that more tips came in, making George Kennedy seem even more like a possible suspect. Two young kids came to authorities and said that they saw when Nevaeh was taken, which is huge, groundbreaking information. And one of those kids was Austin, her best friend. Austin claimed that Nevaeh had been stabbed by a bad man and was dragged into the woods. And the other kid that came to authorities specifically said that she had gone into the woods with someone named Daddy George. So all of this is pretty damning information. However, Austin's mom ended up coming forward saying that he couldn't possibly be telling the truth. Maybe he was with her at the time eating dinner. Maybe she knows there was no way he could have possibly seen anything. But regardless, the other kid that knew specifically the name of Daddy George, I don't know if they were ever able to figure out the validity of that statement. Even with all of this information pointing towards George Kennedy, he wasn't the only person that ended up being arrested within, I believe, like 24 hours that was thought to possibly be involved. Just hours later, and I'm talking like early morning hours, police were told that Jennifer didn't only associate with just one registered sex offender, but at least two. George's friend, Roy Smith. Now, Roy had been charged with sexual assault in 1991, and his history is honestly the most frightening, in my opinion, of the two, because he was labeled as a 4-time habitual offender. And I actually believe he was on probation for one of his previous charges when this specific assault occurred. And he ended up being sentenced to 15 to 50 years in prison, the maximum that he could get, because they said he was such a danger to society. They even told him when he tried to appeal all of this that his patterns and history showed that he was getting worse instead of better. The heinousness of his crime, paired with the fact that this was not his first, it was far from his first, they did not want him released any earlier than he needed to be. But in 2008, ultimately, he was released on parole. And this is when he met Jennifer through George and also had been introduced to Nevaeh. And at this point, like, I just want to repeatedly smack my head on something. I'm so irritated with the fact that Jennifer even allowed any of this. Now, Jennifer did come forward and say that, and I don't know if this makes it honestly worse or better, but she said that she didn't know for sure that Roy was a sex offender, but she had a feeling that he was. And so I don't even know anymore. But regardless, the way that he came into the picture was not just because he knew Nevaeh and Jennifer, which was clearly a problem, but also that van that George had been using where they found that bloody multi-tool that actually belonged to Roy. Now, for one reason or another, which could be relevant or it may not be, I guess that there was like a swapping of cars. George had a Thunderbird. It was swapped for this van that I think actually technically belonged to Roy's nephew. Either way, they both had access to this vehicle. And so Roy was arrested for probation violations just like George. And he too was questioned in Nevaeh's disappearance. Roy was questioned for around a week, I believe, very extensively by the FBI and numerous other officers at like a state and a local level, and he told police that he had an alibi. Roy claimed that he had taken his girlfriend's mother's car to drive a few friends of his to the county inmate dorm on the day that Nevaeh went missing. And he actually did this around 7:15 p.m. that night. Now, I don't know if that's when he dropped his friends off or if that's when he picked his friends up. I mean, I feel like with the time frame, they believe she went missing between 6:30 and 7, so this puts him kind of outside of that. So maybe this is when he says he actually got to this dorm area. Was never able to really narrow it down, but while he was waiting for his friends to finish up their visit, he said he went to a motel. I don't know if it was maybe where George was living. I think it's possible. And he also went to a nearby gas station, and he seemed pretty confident that he had likely been picked up on surveillance along the way, maybe at the gas station. And after this, he picked his friends back up at the inmate dorm and he took them back home. Now, I find this a little bit interesting as an alibi, given the fact that the timing is cutting things very, very close. He did have this period of time where he may have been within just a few miles of the area that Nevaeh went missing. I don't know. There's just something about this that's not sitting right with me. The fact that he had borrowed somebody else's car, he may have even stopped at George's motel, which again, I can't confirm that is where he stopped. But if it was, I thought George was fishing at the time. I have no idea, or at least searching for Nevaeh. I feel like there's a lot of questions in regards to this particular alibi. So at this point, authorities weren't really sure of either story they got from George or Roy. So they wanted to wait for forensics to come back and kept up the search for Nevaeh while George and Roy were having their appeal looked at, and they were figuring out what to do because of the fact both of these men were not in compliance. Now, over the next few days, divers were sent off to two of the local quarries. Hundreds of community members gathered to search around the complex again. There was a nearby Kmart that Nevaeh had gone with her mom the day that she went missing, so they all gathered in this parking lot and just started to make their rounds. And by the Thursday after Nevaeh had vanished, over 240 people had been questioned and 500 tips had come in. You guys, that is just an incredible amount of tips. And I have no clue how they managed to sift through all of these as quickly as they did. But it probably in part has to do with the fact that over 100 state and federal officers were involved in the case. And even the kids at the local high school were wearing yellow. They were tying yellow ribbons to their locker to show support for Nevaeh. This is probably one of the largest joint community efforts that I have ever seen when it comes to a missing person. Nevaeh's story also ended up being picked up on national media. It was on Nancy Grace and America's Most Wanted. There were candlelight vigils that were held, and everyone just prayed that Nevaeh would be brought home safely. Now, I know a lot of you at this point are probably questioning, what about her biological father? If he hadn't been in her life, you know, what's the deal with that? Did he come and look for her? Was he ever ruled out as a person of interest? And there's honestly not that much information out there. What I do know is that her dad lived in Ohio at the time, and I can almost guarantee, just based on the way typically investigations go, that he was probably one of the first people that they spoke to. Because again, like I said, statistically, family members, especially when there is some sort of issue with custody, which there was here, they're the first one police go to. And according to what her dad has said repeatedly, he wanted custody of Nevaeh, and he had fought for it for quite some time because he believed that she would be in much safer hands with him. But I've never seen anywhere in any articles or news interviews or statements by police that he was ever considered a person of interest or that they really ever put a lot of focus on him. And he did in fact show up right away to help search for Nevaeh, and it actually put him in a bit of a precarious situation. He had been unable to pay child support for some time because he had lost his job. And so there was a warrant out for his arrest in the area for failure to pay child support. But he came anyway. He even set up a tent outside of the apartment complex, and he spent day and night searching for Nevaeh. He also fell under heavy criticism, just like Jennifer had, because obviously we know why people weren't happy with Jennifer. But he also fell under heavy criticism because he hadn't been in her life. And there were a lot of people that I feel like wanted to get angry with him. And in situations like this, I just feel like people are so frustrated and they're so upset and they're so angry that something terrible could happen to a little child. And so they want to be able to blame someone actively there. And so that went straight to Nevaeh's parents. But Nevaeh's dad maintained that he only wasn't in her life because of other people. It was never his own personal choice, that he had essentially been forced out of her life by the Buchanans. Now, I obviously can't say what is what here, but I'm more so just sharing this to show the reality of what was happening during this time. I feel like we just never have a great view of what goes on with these families in the middle of this true crime chaos. So many people are affected in so many different ways, and it's heartbreaking. It harms so many people. But the searches were coming up with nothing. So many people were out there, and Nevaeh was just nowhere to be found. And then on Friday, May 29th, the DNA results from the blood found at George's apartment came back. And honestly, I was a little surprised to see that it wasn't Nevaeh's. So many people were so certain that either Roy or George had something to do with Nevaeh's disappearance. And then again, when you look at all that bizarre evidence that was found, it seemed to really support that theory. So it came as a shock to everyone when that wasn't Nevaeh's blood. I don't know whose blood it was, which almost is scarier at that point. Maybe George was telling the truth, or maybe it belonged to someone else. But regardless, for their failure to stay away from children, both George and Roy had their parole revoked and were sent back to prison to finish out their sentences. And now authorities were kind of back to square one. I don't think they ever fully ruled either Roy or George out, but they had no other way to focus on them. So instead, they seemed to narrow their focus onto Jennifer. It was believed that she possibly had more knowledge of what happened to Nevaeh than what she was letting on. She was captured making conflicting statements. She was called out seriously on Nancy Grace for her choices of allowing sexual predators around her daughter. I mean, she even walked out on Nancy Grace during a commercial break in the middle of the show. But I will say, from looking into all the different discrepancies in Jennifer's stories of what happened, majority of it seems like she was just trying to make herself look like less of a crappy mom. She would only usually change her story when someone called her out for a bad decision. For example, like Nancy Grace. Nancy Grace was like, why didn't you watch her walk into Austin's apartment? Like, why did you just let her leave the apartment, walk up those stairs on her own, and go there and hope she arrived there safe and sound? And in the beginning of the interview, she said that's exactly what happened, that she never watched Nevaeh go there. She just hoped hoped and trusted that she would end up in the right spot. But now that Nancy had called her out and really hounded on her over this, she changed her story to saying that she physically watched Nevaeh go through Austin's front door. So those are the kind of discrepancies we're talking about here, where it just seems like she was more so trying to make herself look less bad than she's trying to hide anything. But after hours and hours of questioning her, police said that they just didn't really have anything to suggest she was involved. I mean, she didn't have her own vehicle at the time. She was with somebody else, so I feel like that kind of provides an alibi in itself. She couldn't have taken Nevaeh anywhere far from the complex. She was there looking for Nevaeh between 7 and 8. Still, maybe she knew more than she was letting on, but she likely wasn't actively involved in whatever happened to Nevaeh. And then on Sunday, May 31st, a third person of interest entered the picture. And like, these people popping out of the woodwork, I am honestly terrified for this community because of the kinds of people that are in it. 63-year-old James Easter. And I'm just kind of assuming this information because I couldn't directly find it anywhere. But it seems that they were told that James would frequently hang out around the apartment complex. He didn't live there, but I guess he may have possibly had a lady friend there. I don't know if there was anything else that led them directly to him. I couldn't find any sort of criminal history on him, but honestly, it was very difficult to find anything on any of these men, and we know two of them had extensive criminal history. So authorities went to his home to speak to him, and they ended up doing a search right away. And I don't know if he allowed it or if they went already with a warrant, but they found some pretty alarming things. They found hundreds of pieces of potential evidence, and majority of that was porn. But he also had Barbie dolls for some reason and a bunch of other random things in his home. And so they're looking at all of this thinking, okay, maybe we have another, you know, sadistic sexual predator on the loose here. And so they briefly questioned him, and he adamantly denied having any involvement in Nevaeh's disappearance. And he even said he was able to provide them with proof of an alibi. So ultimately, they had to let him go. Now, I don't know and have not been able to find anywhere what his alibi was, which is kind of frustrating because I really enjoyed picking apart Roy's alibi. But whatever he gave was obviously enough for them to say, okay, we have no choice but to move on. But within hours of him returning home, he ended up being arrested on unrelated charges, but sketchy charges nonetheless. Now, whether it was a neighbor who happened to see this, there's theories that maybe police were surveilling him. Someone caught James Easter burning things in his backyard at 5 in the morning. Again, just hours after he spoke to authorities. Ellie ended up storming his home in the middle of his little fire fest that he had going on and found that he was burning TV dinners, which I think is just a really weird thing to burn, especially because I feel like they're kind of like connected to kids in a way. That's like a very common thing for kids to eat. He also was burning a sex toy, which he said he was burning it because it was overused. I don't want to go into it anyways. And he also was burning receipts. It just seemed like such an odd collection of things to burn. And I know that people burn their trash a lot. It is not an uncommon thing. But when you've just been questioned by authorities in possible connection to a missing child and you're burning items in your backyard, that's definitely a little suspicious. So he ended up being arrested on arson charges. And authorities, I'm assuming, tried to see if maybe any of those things he was burning ended up being related to the disappearance. But nothing seemed to come from it because by June 1st, James Easter was released and it was announced by the judge that he was not at all connected to the case. So another possibility, another person of interest, literally in every sense of the phrase, went up in flames. Over the next few days, authorities tried to calm the public because they were rightly so terrified. We're talking about the beginning of summer. Parents were probably so excited to let their kids go run free in the neighborhood. And now they were scared too. The kids themselves didn't feel safe going outside. Parents didn't feel safe letting their kids outside. And everyone was like side-eyeing their neighbor, unsure if maybe that person was a child abductor in secret. But while trying to calm the public, I feel like the FBI also said many things that are probably the least calming thing you can say. For instance, they said it could take years to solve Nevaeh's case, which to me it kind of made me sad because that seems like they already knew Nevaeh wasn't coming home. So they not only squashed the hope of finding Nevaeh, but also left this lingering fear that they had been trying so hard to dispel that the public was in danger. They still had two separate vans that they were looking for. They announced that they were questioning someone that, you know, ran an ice cream truck. They also offered a $20,000 reward at this point for any information on the case, alongside a private reward of $8,000. The Salvation Army was providing over 300 meals a day at this point to LE to help them get through the searches. That is how extensive and exhausting everything was. And not only were LE still out there pushing, leaving no stone unturned, but the community was still out strong as well. But on June 4th, a horrific discovery was made. A fisherman from the area named Guy Bickley was out with his 15-year-old son, Ryan, and they had plans to go fishing that day and ultimately decided to try out a new spot that they had heard of from other fishermen. And this spot is in Raisinville, and it runs along the River Raisin, which is one of the main rivers in the area, and this river goes directly through Monroe. Now, there's no obvious pull-off areas for this fishing spot. It's not even well known, it seems. It's kind of like a secret with all of the avid fishermen, and at that point, not even all of them, obviously, because this, you know, group didn't even know, but it's a very remote area, and it's about 12 or so miles from the Charlotte Arms apartment complex where Nevaeh went missing. When they got there, they had to park on the other side of the guardrail, so no one just took out their car, and they had to find this overgrown trail that would take them down to the river. They walked a bit along the bank, trying to pick out a perfect spot, and after fishing for a bit, they decided to head to a different area for better access. And this took them along some rocks, and there was this concrete block just like randomly there. And they noticed that there were flies all over the ground. You know, the area smelled terrible. And so at first they just thought someone was fishing there, caught a fish, never took it home. But eventually, when one of them was walking along that concrete block, a portion of it broke away. And at that point, the smell and the flies intensified. So they decided to take a closer look. And so they began crumbling away some of the concrete, some of the cement, and they saw skin and hair and immediately called the police. Ellie arrived at River Raisin and began the very slow process of excavating what was now believed to be remains encased in that cement block. And everyone just kind of knew exactly who it likely would be. Now, there is not much detail out there on the scene other than the fact that the appearance of the remains seemed to match that of Nevaeh in terms of size, age, clothing, but they obviously had to wait for DNA testing to confirm. Ellie spent the next few days scouring the bank of River Raisin, and they held a press conference to speak on the remains found. Sheriff Tillman Crutchfield said that he believed whoever was responsible for the death of this person, that likely was Nevaeh, was a local, or at the very least, someone very familiar with the area. This location, as I've already stated, was not widely known or heavily traveled. It's out there. It's not obviously marked. It's just known amongst the fishermen in the area. And so they asked anyone who had fished there recently to come forward if they saw anything odd. And despite not having much information of what was found on the scene, and there are a lot of, you know, small details out there that I've not been able to personally confirmed through like LE or news articles, press releases. The one thing that I have seen out there is that police found a 90-pound bag of cement, which is obviously what was likely used to encase these remains, but also that is a very oddly specific size bag. And so they wanted to find out where someone could have purchased this bag, hoping that maybe it led them to the perpetrator. And very quickly, they announced that there was only one store in the entire area that sold it. That store was Coleman Concrete, and you're never gonna guess where this backs up to. The motel that George stayed at. They're literally side by side. And not just that, when authorities spoke to Coleman Concrete, they said that recently their fence had been cut. So either it was one of their workers, someone that frequently purchased from them, or someone managed to cut the fence, go in there and grab a bag of concrete with full intentions of burying this body in it. And while authorities were trying to narrow that down, the DNA ended up coming back, and it confirmed that these remains were, in fact, 5-year-old Nevaeh. Nevaeh had been face down underneath this concrete, and the autopsy indicated that she had died from suffocating on the dirt particles that ended up in her mouth. They believed that the concrete had been dumped on top of her dry, and then someone used the river water to solidify it. And it was likely she had been buried alive. They were unable to say if someone physically pressed her into the dirt to suffocate her or if she suffocated from someone physically putting the concrete on top of her, preventing her from getting up. Honestly, it doesn't matter which way it goes, it's heartbreaking. Many members of her family expressed that they strongly felt that George was involved in Nevaeh's death. They had already felt this so strongly. And then all of just the circumstances and the fact that now this concrete company that sells the same bag of concrete she was found under is directly behind his motel. I mean, come on. Like, even though the blood found in his motel room didn't belong to Nevaeh, that alone does not rule out that he was not capable of harming her. He and Roy both knew Nevaeh. George especially would have been someone that she would happily go off with, not aware that she could be in danger. She thought that she could trust him. According to that one witness, she went off in the woods with Daddy George. But in his jailhouse interviews that he did, he remained adamant that he never touched her. Quote, I didn't take her, and I definitely didn't kill her. I have no clue. I wish that I did have some clue. Also, at this point, Jennifer was no longer defending George like she originally had. Now she was saying in interviews that she didn't put anything past him. Again, I don't know if she's just switching things up to make herself look like a less terrible mother, or if she was just saying this because she genuinely was kind of realizing the reality of the situation. Roy, well, mainly Roy's family, also remained adamant that he had no part in whatever happened to Nevaeh, and it was honestly kind of upsetting to see some of the statements his mother made, because I have read all of his, like, habeas corpus files and everything in regards to him trying to get out of his charges, and the way his crimes, his sexual crimes against people were described, like, it is so disgusting, it is vile. And his mom tried to say that this girl, quote, cried rape, that it was a big lie to just make him look bad. And, it just put my stomach into knots reading that. Now, James Easter, on the other hand, was very vocal himself and almost welcoming of interviews. Like, I already think this guy is just an odd character, but this is what, like, really tipped the iceberg for me. Despite the fact that he was, according to the judge and Ellie, ruled out, and he seems to even be like the only person that I've seen it directly stated he wasn't involved, but his behavior was so weird. He openly admitted in these interviews that he had failed certain questions on the polygraph they gave him, which I will say, take that with a grain of salt, because so did George and so did Jennifer. Everyone was like very open with the fact that they failed their polygraphs. But I will say, polygraphs are not reliable, so I'm not putting much weight into it. But this guy, James Easter, just really wanted to talk about how he failed it, and he wanted to be a part of the investigation, and he wanted to be a part of all of the media, and he openly spoke about what kinds of questions the FBI asked him during this polygraph. And he told the media that they asked him how he would have committed the crime if he had done it. And he went into disturbing detail about it. He spoke about the best locations to take a kid from the Charlotte Arms apartment complex, when and who does their security rounds there. I mean, he physically acted out how he would hold a child down and what that would feel like. He acted out splashing the water on the concrete. You know, he was saying how the killer would be feeling probably in that moment. But it just doesn't seem like even after this, there was a lot of focus on James Easter. I mean, maybe he's just a weird guy, but I just have this bad, bad feeling about him. But still, no one was named a suspect, and eventually the media quieted down, but the community was still reeling over this loss. How unbelievable it all felt that a 5-year-old innocent little girl could be so brutally murdered, and possibly by someone that she knew. And on June 13th, everyone came together to say their final goodbyes to Nevaeh. The funeral home had a 2-day wake to accommodate all of the people that wanted to be there. Their phone was ringing off the hook with people making donations to her memorial fund. They wanted to make sure she had the funeral that she deserved, the burial that she deserved. Honestly, it was, again, one of the most beautiful examples of a community coming together. They had over 100 motorcycles rally for Nevaeh, and she would have loved that. Her white casket was pulled by a motorcycle through the streets of Monroe, and the streets were lined with people releasing balloons and saying prayers for this sweet little girl. In response to the mass pain that the community felt, the town offered several grief sessions for everyone to attend, which again is just one of the best things I have ever heard. And I mean, they continued this for an extended period of time. So anyone who was struggling with what happened to Nevaeh could come in and get some sort of help and not feel alone and some sort of guidance on how to move forward. And while this was a beautiful send-off, a love-filled send-off for Nevaeh, she still didn't have justice. At this point, she wasn't on the front of the newspapers anymore. When the searches died down, so did the chatter, and authorities really weren't saying much either. The autopsy did show that she had no signs of drugs in her system, but strangely, it also didn't mention sexual assault, and authorities never spoke on it either. Now, Jennifer did come forward saying there were no signs of sexual assault, that there were no signs of injuries, but no one to this day can be positive. And I just find that so strange because of the fact that the entirety of the case is so focused around sex offenders. So maybe they're just not talking about it because they want to not compromise the investigation. They don't want to scare somebody off.
Not a day goes by that I don't think about her.
Jennifer Buchanan asked us not to show her face, but she says there's no hiding the heartache she feels every day over the murder of her daughter, Nevaeh.
I want justice for Nevaeh more than anyone. It's been 3 years. No new information, no arrests.
Soon after Nevaeh's disappearance, investigators named some persons of interest in the case, including sex offenders George Kennedy and Roy Smith. Both were friends of Jennifer Buchanan's, but they were never charged. Both are locked up on unrelated cases.
I think they have answers. I can't tell you for sure if they had anything to do with it.
In my heart, I still believe right now today that they have a great deal of it to do with it.
Now 3 years since her death, Nevaeh's grandmother and mother say they will never give up on solving this mystery. They continue to hold on to hope that someone will come forward with the truth.
If this person is listening, you need to come clean.
There's no closure. There's always going to be a huge hole in my heart, even if they find out who did it.
Now, a distant family member, Risa Smith, ended up creating a Facebook page for Nevaeh, and she started her own investigation into her murder. They held Justice for Nevaeh rally events to teach child safety. I mean, they were like doing something every single month for years. They also started poster campaigns to encourage getting Nevaeh's face out there again because things had quieted down so much. And one of the campaigns, they spoke directly to her killer. The poster said, quote, "Tell me, how do you sleep at night knowing what you did to me?" They increased the reward to $50,000, hoping for tips, but it wasn't until 2012 that there seemed to be more movement in the case again. The sheriff came forward, and to everyone's relief, he said that they were the closest they had ever been to making an arrest. And they had someone specific that they believed was responsible. This was something that people had been waiting on for years. People still did not feel safe. People obviously were still wondering who could do this to a child. But despite making this announcement, just days later, they made another one saying that they were back at square one. And in 2014, the same exact thing happened again. Investigators came forward saying that they had narrowed things down to who they believed was Nevaeh's killer. And this time, it really did sound like they were confident. Not enough to release this person's name, which I feel like they didn't do that because of what happened with George and Roy and James, and then also the scrutiny against Jennifer and Nevaeh's dad. But they did give a lot of details otherwise. Authorities said that this new person they were looking into and they were closing in on had lived in Monroe their entire life. So they already fit the bill of knowing possibly where this remote fishing spot would be, being familiar with the apartment complex. And apparently he had struggles a lot. He struggled when he was a teen. And as of this announcement, he was 30 years old and was currently incarcerated on unrelated charges. And I've not seen it listed anywhere what those charges were, if they had anything to do with sexual assault or kidnapping or children just in general, but they told the public that this guy had been on their radar from the beginning, that they had actually interviewed him when this first happened. I honestly wonder if he lived at the apartment complex or lived very close nearby, if he was maybe a visitor at the apartment complex. They also said they had interviewed him more extensively recently, but he, quote, refused to confess, which tells me that despite their confidence, they were relying on a confession to make that arrest. They didn't have enough physical evidence otherwise to connect these dots. But with this new information released, they also released that if this man was in fact involved, that this was one of those very, very rare cases of this being a stranger abduction. He had no connection to Nevaeh. He had never met her before. And so this was an impulsive kidnapping and killing of this poor, sweet little girl. But just like in 2012, despite this announcement, nothing to this day seems to have come from it. But they've also not said if it was ruled out, like if they changed their focus. It was kind of like this huge thing and then it was nothing.
Today marks 5 years since Nevaeh was taken while playing outside an apartment complex. Now the community gathered here within the last hour at St. Mary's Park to honor her life. They say they are still fighting for justice in this tragic case. As you may remember, the body of that five-year-old girl was found encased in cement in a shallow grave along the banks of River Raisin a few weeks after she disappeared. Her killer is still on the loose. Friends, family, and search volunteers from years ago are back out here remembering Nevaeh's life with a vigil and balloon release. They are also pleading with the public for more tips involving this murder. There is a $50,000 reward for information leading to an arrest in this case.
We want this to be done with, give the family closure. It'll never be over. You know, this will always be with us. But knowing that they have the person and he's going to be in prison for the rest of his life, that's what we want.
In 2015, when things were still quiet, Nevaeh's cousin, Risa Smith, said that she was not giving up on finding out what happened to Nevaeh. She actually has a binder that is packed with notes and interviews and theories of her own that she has put together after all of these years. She even switched her career from business admin to criminal justice to be able to fight for Nevaeh better. She created a nonprofit called Focus on the Children, and she said, quote, "I ask myself all the time, did they wake up and have a bad day? What was going through their minds? How could they have done this? What were they thinking? I mean, did she cry? Did she beg them to stop?" That person has to live with that, and it just blows my mind to think someone could live with that. They continued to do a lot of different events, and in 2020, George ended up being released after serving out his full prison term. Roy also has long since been released, and according to the active sex offender website in Michigan, he is in compliance. But I have absolutely no idea where Easter is. Like, I just still can't really find a lot of details on these men. As of 2021, Monroe County's new sheriff, Troy Goodenough, came forward and said that this case is far from cold.
The detectives that were on this case had children at or near her age when this happened. And I'm confident it had a blow on them.
Monroe County Sheriff Troy Goodenough has been with the department for more than 30 years. He witnessed the strain the case put on the community and on his office.
I can tell you the impact it had had on the emotional well-being of our organization was significant.
Smith, who has a criminal justice degree, has spent years looking into the case, compiling binders of notes and even interviews.
I just have a hard time understanding how anybody, I still get emotional after 10 years, how anybody can abduct and murder a five-year-old child.
It is a very sick or disturbed person we're looking for. A person that is able to abduct and murder an innocent five-year-old child.
Our approach in this case, no one is ruled out. And again, that's not a negative to those folks. I'm just saying is if I come out here today and say person A is ruled out, now I'm undermining what these detectives are doing when they're analyzing this data. We're dissecting this investigation into very small parts and we're tackling each part independently.
They have partnered with Ann Arbor FBI special agents to create a new team to go through all of the evidence again. I know they have been re-interviewing witnesses. They hope to use new forensic technology to maybe get them somewhere. And so there is still an active investigation going on. And that same year, there was also potentially a break in the case leading to a new suspect. So this is another person that I've not been able to find a lot of information on. I don't know if this person is potentially one of the three we've already spoken about. There's not a lot out there. I have looked endlessly through arrest records and all of these things to try to connect dots, and I just can't find it. But 11 Investigates decided to take a deep dive into the case, into Nevaeh's disappearance and death, and it produced a new witness. Now, this woman apparently had not publicly come forward until this moment. And even when she did come forward, she wanted to keep her identity anonymous. She told 11 Investigates that the day before Nevaeh went missing, she saw Nevaeh deflate air from the tire of a black car parked in the parking lot. And this moment and memory stuck out to her because she actually went and told Nevaeh's mom. So she tattled on her and felt really bad about it. And so it's just something that stuck out in the back of her mind because the next day, that same little girl went missing. Now, this woman said that this car was one that she had never seen before. And the following day, which was the day Nevaeh went missing, it was still there. But when Nevaeh went missing, the car disappeared as well. Now, typically when a tip like this comes in so long after the fact, it is met, understandably, by quite a bit of scrutiny because, you know, why are you just coming forward now? Like, how do you still remember this at this point? Just, there's a lot of things. I'm not saying that tips this late in the game are not helpful because they absolutely are, and it's what these cases rely on. But obviously, it takes this extra level of vetting. But it seems like Ellie ended up putting a lot of weight into this new tip. So it turns out that at another apartment complex, just 3.2 miles away from where Nevaeh lived, only hours before she vanished, there was an incident. A man showed up to that apartment complex and lured two kids there to the dumpsters and the parking lot of the complex and proceeded to expose himself to them. Now, the kids saw him run to a black Grand Prix and drive off, but thankfully, they managed to snag a partial plate before he was able to fully leave. And they reached out to the police, gave them this partial plate, and they were able to match it to a man in the area. Now, they, again, as I've said, have not released who this man is, but they did say that he ultimately pled guilty to obscene conduct charges, which is what I was trying to use to locate this guy, but I've not been able to find anything. I've not even been able to find any news articles that are still active about this incident occurring. However, what makes this interesting, obviously, is the proximity and the time of this occurrence, obviously the intentions of this person, and not just that, but this guy drove a black car, which this new witness said was hanging out around the area, and this guy was also friends with Roy Smith, which apparently this whole area just has like this interwoven web of sex offender friends just all over this one particular area, like in this like 5 mile radius, which is disgusting and wild to me. And even more baffling because there's so many schools in the area, I digress. When police spoke to this guy's parents, I guess they said that he had a very particular routine. He would wake up, shower, get dressed, and then they said that he was always gone all day long, and they weren't really ever sure what he did, but they did know that he was an avid fisherman in the area. I mean, it's just so crazy to me that we've had so many different potential suspects that all seem so possibly involved, yet nothing has happened yet. No arrests have been made. No full connections have been made. I do know that authorities spoke to this woman and clearly know who this guy is, but I've seen no movement otherwise in his potential involvement. Like, there is absolutely nothing. Now, obviously, there's still an active investigation into this case. Not only are Ellie investigating, but her cousin, Risa Smith, is still investigating. I don't know what the status of her mother, Jennifer, is, but I do know that her dad, along with two of his other children, her half-siblings, still try to get justice for Nevaeh and honor her. There is a memorial that was created around the location that her body was found. And every year around the time she went missing, her dad goes out and freshens up the area, puts out new flowers, keeps things clean, maintenance, so that one day they finally get answers. This case is such a double-edged sword because it's so frustrating having cases where it feels like there's no leads, there's no tips, there's nothing to go off of. But on the flip side, when you have so many people that look like they absolutely could have committed this crime and you can't connect a single one of them, I can only imagine that that is equally, if not more, frustrating than having nothing at all. I am hoping that they manage to gather some sort of forensics off of something, whether that be Nevaeh, whether that be that cement bag. I mean, I just hope that there was something there. I've seen there were potentially carpet fibers found on her body, under her nails maybe. Could those just be from her playing around on the floor with her friends that day? Maybe. Could it be potentially from someone's car? Also a possibility. I just hope there is something there for them to work with. But I will say it's a little disheartening to know that the FBI has been working on the case. They've been re-interviewing people for years at this point, and there still have been no arrests made. And I feel like the amount of people that have already put in tips and been questioned, I worry there's not much more to find. And this little girl deserves justice. And whoever is capable of doing this to a little five-year-old girl needs to be thrown in prison. Now, if they were correct that that one person that was already incarcerated was involved, at least that person's incarcerated and hopefully is still incarcerated. But again, we just don't know, and the community is still living in fear. I personally think it is very possible that this was someone very close to Nevaeh that impulsively acted on some sort of urge, but because they did have this very like minuscule level of care for her, for instance, like George, that maybe they ended up not being able to go through with it, but also knew that they couldn't risk her telling on them. And so I feel like that is potentially why she was killed in the way that she was. I feel like someone possibly had some guilt there. I'm just trying to think of like motive here and why someone would do this, but also apparently not sexually assault her, didn't harm her in any other way, just took her, drove her miles away, put her face down in the dirt, potentially like didn't even have their hands on her and killed her by suffocating her. I just feel like that is a very specific kind of attack. It is very specific kind of motive that would lead to doing something like that to her. I hope that eventually there are answers for little Nevaeh, and whoever is responsible for this is thrown in prison for what they have done. I'm interested to hear what you guys have to say down in the comment section down below. Again, remember to please be as respectful as possible. On that note, I'm going to go ahead and go, you guys. If you haven't already, go ahead and hit the subscribe button down below to become a part of the Hallan fam so that we can hopefully bring them home together or bring them justice together. And I will see you guys in my next video. Bye.